thank you so much, Governor Deal, for being available to speak about something that it seems is near and dear to your heart, and that is criminal justice reform. I'm curious why you felt it was such an important thing to sign that executive order that established the council, or the special council for criminal justice reform. What was that, 2013?
Well, actually, I made criminal justice reform an issue in my first State of the State address in January of 2011, and then proceeded to appoint a criminal justice reform commission, and they made their first report, I believe, in 2012. And that first report dealt with the front end of the system, and that is, how do we divert nonviolent offenders away from our prisons? There were a lot of motivations for it, certainly on a financial point of view. We were the fourth largest prison population in the country, even though our total population was only the 10th largest at that time. It was costing us well over $1 billion a year, and we were seeing high recidivism rates. So therefore, the idea that you are going to break patterns by long imprisonment was proving to be false. So, but on another note, I felt it was the right thing to do. We had ignored this issue for too long. Our state, like many states, had been stuck in the model of get tough on crime, convict them, and throw away the key and don't worry about the consequences. That wasn't working. When you had almost one out of every three adults that was returning to our prison system after they had been released, that recidivism rate was too high. It was even higher in our juvenile population. Something like 65% were coming back within 3 years or less. So from both a practical and I think a humanitarian point of view, it was something we needed to look at.
Where did that come from in your consciousness? I mean, to what do you attribute your concern for this? It doesn't perhaps...
Well, I suppose my concern was heightened by the fact that Sandra and I's oldest child, our only son, is a Superior Court judge in the Northeastern Judicial Circuit. And he is a judge of an accountability court dealing with drug court. And so he had asked me to speak at some of his drug court graduations, and I heard the stories of those whose lives had been resurrected and changed, and I saw that it was actually working. So that was a really important motivation for me. And I was surprised, quite frankly, by the reception. At the beginning, when I made that State of the State address, some people said, well, this does not sound like a Republican governor's initiative. Why are you doing it? I said, well, it's the right thing to do. Hard to argue with that one. But after they made their first recommendation in 2000, and we came back in 2012 to implement the accountability court portion of it, it passed the General Assembly unanimously. The second year we took up juvenile justice reform, it too passed the General Assembly unanimously. I jokingly say you can't even pass an adjournment resolution unanimously in our legislature, but I think the education process of people taking a look at something that many of them have not thought about or looked at in the past convinced them that it was the right thing to do. And we have gone every year that I have been in office making additional adjustments and additional provisions in terms of reforming our criminal justice system. We have had very, very little dissent in terms of votes in the General Assembly. So it has generally been accepted very well, I think, by the legislators, and I think it's been very well accepted by the public.
And one of the most recent initiatives was a Senate Bill 407, which, did I have the numbers right, it reformed the misdemeanor bail practices and added community service and educational opportunities.
That's right. That was one of the areas that the council had been hearing from people about. It's very difficult to justify keeping someone in jail for a long period of time for a misdemeanor just because they don't have the money to pay a bail bondsman or to post cash bond. And there again, that was the right thing to do. We gave the judges more discretion and we gave some guidelines that they could follow, which I think will help in the long run.
And what would you consider, perhaps, your greatest achievement in criminal justice reform? Perhaps something you've already referred to, but is there anything that you really hold up?
I think it is a cumulative package. By starting on the front end and diverting nonviolent offenders out of prisons that were costing about $19,000 per bed per year, the ability to divert juveniles into community-based programs that has a very high success rate. And most people didn't realize it was costing $91,000 a year to keep a juvenile in our juvenile justice system. That is an extremely high cost. Both of those have proven to be very successful. We then moved into the prison system itself. And one of the most important questions I asked at the beginning was, what's the most common characteristic of those who are incarcerated in our state prison system? The answer came back, it's because they dropped out of high school. They do not have a basic elementary degree, which is a high school diploma. So we began to start on that. And we realized that if you're going to cut down on your recidivism rate, that is those who get out and then come back, then you have to eliminate some of the conditions that caused them to come to the prisons in the first place. And one of those was education. We have had a very successful emphasis on education within our prison system. We have dramatically increased the number of GEDs that are being awarded to inmates in the prison system. We've even contracted with a private charter school to come in and teach high school classes so that they can get a high school diploma rather than just a GED, which makes a difference to some employers. We've also found statistically, and this is one that is really important, I think, is that your recidivism rate, our recidivism rate, dropped by about 19% for those who got a GED or high school equivalent while they were incarcerated versus the other population in the system. But it dropped 24% if you gave them a blue-collar skill, a technical skill. And what that relates to is, both of them actually, but that one in particular, there are two things that when you have someone released from a prison that are primarily important. One is a place to live, and secondly, a job. They're not going to get a job if they don't have at least a high school diploma or a GED, but if they have a technical skill where they can have a certificate that they take to their prospective employer and be able to show them that this is a skill set that the state of Georgia has given to me and they are standing behind me in that regard. And we give them those kind of certificates. So housing and employment are two of the most important factors to cut down on your recidivism rate.
And then what kinds of incentives can be put in place, both in the public and private sector, then to hire these individuals after they receive those degrees or certificates?
Right. Well, we're not going to pay people to hire inmates. There are too many people who've never been in trouble that have trouble getting a job. That would not be quite fair to them. But what we can do is try to overcome the stigma of their convictions. And that is why we give them a certificate to take to a prospective employer to say, this is what I have done. And then we did something at the state level that we were trying to lead by example rather than mandating upon private employers. And that was, we banned the box for those who are applying for jobs within the state government. Now what that means, simply put, is that when you're filling out an application for a job, there are several boxes you have to check. One of those is, have you ever been convicted of a felony? Well, the truth of the matter is that if you check that box, and they have to check that box if that's true, that application doesn't get past the human resources director, and they never get a chance to explain to somebody what has changed about their life, why they would be a good employee. We said, if you are having to check that box, but if you're applying for a job with the state of Georgia, you will get a face-to-face interview with someone from that department that you're applying to let them hear your story, why you think you have been rehabilitated, and why you think you would be a good person for the job that you're applying for. Now, some industries have begun to follow that pattern, and some local governments are beginning to follow that pattern. We are very pleased with that. We hope that it will continue to spread.
be interested in finding out which ones. I think that's very interesting, because I do understand that even if somebody doesn't check the box, someone does a background check, which is easy to do in the era of the internet, that there's right. still some barriers to employment and housing as well.
There are, and I have spoken all the way up the chain in terms of federal assistance in that regard.
And I understand you did meet with President Trump, speaking of which.
I met with the President. I spoke to him about it. I spoke to Dr. Ben Carson, who is the Secretary of HUD, and I told Dr. Carson in particular, I said, you know, most housing authorities will not allow a convicted felon who's been paroled to have an apartment in their housing complex. And I said, you need to do something about that. Well, I knew the answer was going to be, well, local housing authorities have their own board of directors and they make their decisions, not HUD. I quickly reminded them that most housing authorities depend very heavily on the federal funds that flow through his department and his Office of Housing and Urban Development. So I planted the seeds. Our district director for HUD, by the way, who I had the same conversation with, says that they are making real progress in that regard. And I appreciate her willingness to entertain that they can have a role in this. They need to have a role in this. And I'm pleased to see it is beginning to happen.
You know, you mentioned the notion of ending the stigma, and certainly, you know, on the legislative side, you know, your advocacy. What do you think really is going to need to take place? I know for myself, it took a great deal of education and immersion in this, but I would hope that, you know, perhaps something else could happen that we would end the stigma for addiction, mental health, but also for.
Well, there are a lot of things that have been suggested. And one is expungement of certain convictions off of someone's record so that it does not show. It would certainly have to show in terms of law enforcement. We have not entertained that to a significant degree up to this point. You have to go incrementally with these kinds of reforms. And we have done that successfully, I might add. And I think this will be one of those things that people will continue to look at. Because the truth of the matter is, you could be rehabilitated all you want to be rehabilitated, but in the minds of many people, if you have to say you are a convicted felon or if it shows up on your record, then your chances of good employment are not very good. So we have encouraged our licensing boards to be more careful about entertaining explanations about convictions before they just arbitrarily deny licenses to individuals. So we're making progress, and I think the more public education we can have in the private sector about how important these things are, the more success we'll have.
Education is a key to so much, isn't it? I understand that you present a gavel made by an inmate to every judge you appoint. Right. Why do you do that?
Well, as I tell them, this is a gavel that's made by inmates in our state prison system. You'll be having to make choices. Sometimes you will be sending people to that prison system. But I want you to display it so that you'll be reminded every time you look at it that even those who make bad mistakes and you have to punish through our justice system, even they have redeeming values. I think that's an important thing for a judge to not forget.
And I know it's quite emotional. I'm gonna stay here for a second because I understand that many times when people question, you know, those who come out of our criminal justice system, you tell them, go to an accountability court graduation and if you want to be inspired and motivated.
Yes, I have such a tender heart. I can't go to them anymore because the stories that you hear of redeemed lives is truly amazing. And I tell my preacher friends, I said, if you ever run out of sermon material, just go to a drug court graduation or a DUI court graduation, and you'll have plenty of material to talk about. And the truth of the matter is that not just on a humanitarian side does that make sense, that you understand that. It makes sense on an economic standpoint. We've calculated that those individuals who go to an accountability court and are successful in changing their lives, and by the way, we've done a study and it's remarkable what the results are. We found that for those who went through a an accountability court and graduated, the recidivism rate is only 2%. That is exceptionally low. But when they go to an accountability court, one of the things they're required to do is to have a job. And we calculate that the economic positive impact from those individuals is over $38 million a year. It is that they're paying taxes instead of draining on other people's taxes that they're paying. It goes in terms of not having to pay for very expensive prison beds, supervision of it, and all of the other things that go with it. It also shows up in the fact that it sometimes allows them to be able to keep the custody of their children rather than their children winding up in foster care where the taxpayers have to pay for it. So it's a good move all the way around for those who qualify. I want to make sure that everybody understands, however, there are reasons for having prisons. What we have seen is that our percentage of those who are violent criminals, the percentage in our prison system has gone up by about 10%. That's the way it should be. We should be whittling away on those who are not classified as violent and finding other alternative placements for them, which is what we're doing. But there's always going to be a need for prisons for those who are violent, those who are a danger to society, and that's what prisons should be for.
And I noticed, I think it was on the report on your website regarding the criminal justice reform, that the numbers of prison inmates in Georgia was expected to go as far as 60,000, it's down to 52,000. And yes, the percentage of people of color, of African Americans, is at historic lows as well.
Yes, African American males' percentage has dropped about 29.2%. African American females has dropped over 38%. We were disproportionate in terms of incarceration of people of color in the prison system. This has tended to level that out a little bit more than it has been in the past. But the truth of the matter is, all of these, drug courts, DUI courts, all of those, many of the crimes that we see are related to addictions. And the truth is that unless you deal with those addictions effectively, either through treatment, counseling, etc., incarceration does not break those addictions. So that's the reason that these accountability courts are so successful, is that they concentrate on the issue that got them in trouble in the first place and try to break those habits. Drug court, for example, is on average about a 2-year process. They're monitored by counselors. They are required to take unannounced drug screens. They're required to have a job. So by the time they confront their issues and deal with them, then that's what makes them successful when they get out of the program and they graduate. Some of the most rewarding conversations I've had are from individuals who thank me for creating drug courts and DUI courts, etc., because they say it has saved my life. And I think that is the case in many of these individuals' cases. So I think that's a good thing. We should all take pride in that.
Now, I want to be conscious of time. Eek! I don't know if my wife, sometimes I watch fast, but I want to ask if there's any, I guess, undone business, anything that you see in the last few months of your governorship that you would like to do in terms of criminal.
I would hope that whoever my successor is would take this as an issue that needs to be continued. We did it, as I said, incrementally. If you try to rush too many things at one time, you do not have the ability to know the success of what you've done. So we have done it incrementally for the last 7 years now. There will be other things that need to be tweaked, and I would hope that the next governor and the next members of the General Assemblies will be accepting of that process. I think the council and the Criminal Justice Reform Commission is a good way to do it. It tries to include as many people who are knowledgeable on the issues related to this subject and get their expert advice, get their expert recommendations as we move forward with legislation. There's certainly a lot of other things we can do, and I'm hopeful that our state's going to continue to lead the charge in that regard. I just got a letter from a member of the General Assembly who had been to a conference of state legislators, and he was thanking me. He said, I did not really realize how far ahead of all these other states Georgia was. And he said, I had the opportunity to tell them what we've done, and they were in disbelief because they did not think they could achieve that. So hopefully we will give legislative members in other states the confidence that if they move in this direction, they can be successful.
And in what areas do you see that? Perhaps some changes in the probation system?
It's really all across the board. Since you mentioned probation, one of the hang-ups that we had in our system was that previously we had, if you were on probation by virtue of a sentence of a judge, you had a probation officer. After you were released from prison, you still had a probation officer to supervise the probation part of your sentence. Then if you were paroled, you had a parole officer. We finally were able to consolidate those into our Department of Community Affairs, Community Services rather. And instead of having a parole officer's car at your house, another car that is your probation officer's car, and having to report to two different entities, and in some cases, if it's a juvenile involved, you may even have a juvenile probation officer there. So that consolidation has been much more effective, and it has also saved us a lot of money in the process.
I was actually at a Stations of Hope training a few months ago, and I thought that was interesting, working directly with the churches and faith communities.
Yes.
To help to, you know, encourage community support, because I think that's in some ways what seems to be lacking for so many, which increases recidivism.
Yes, having community support is essential. The employer community, of course, is one of the real sources that can aid this process through employment. But we have many religious organizations who in their own communities are doing their part of being able to deal with these issues. And many of them are also undertaking housing projects where they will provide a certain amount of housing for returning citizens in their community, which is very, very helpful. They do a lot for the state in that regard, and it doesn't cost the state any money. It actually saves us money.
I must tell you, I'm so grateful to have an opportunity to speak to you about this, and also as an individual to learn about even using the expression returning citizens.
Right.
You know, I think that's so important. Is there anything that I did not ask you that you would like to add about this subject?
Well, I think you've covered the waterfront pretty well. We went from the front end, and we've now come all the way through the prison system to the tail end, which is the reentry process. Reentry is a very, very important part of that chain of moving through the system. Because as I said, if you do not have successful reentry, then you'll start the process all over again because they will reoffend and they will start back at the beginning of serving another sentence. So you can do all the things that you want to do about reforming a lot of other things, but if you do not deal with those who are in the system, and almost all of them will at some point in time be paroled. So they will be back in our society. We just need to make sure that when they return, they have the best chance of not coming back, and that's what we hope.
When we began our conversation, we were talking about your wife and how she, you know, reads to children in school, and I keep thinking, here are the two of you. Are, you know, really modeling perhaps what it takes, starting at the front, really the front end.
Yes.
And making sure kids have a good basis in literacy and education. You know, so perhaps that would encourage them then even in high school to continue and graduate and less
Absolutely.
Likely to end up in the prison system.
Well, so. I've always said the most successful criminal justice reform would be education reform. When you see that almost 70% of those in our prisons did not graduate from high school, there's something missing in the system. And that's why, from my wife's perspective as an educator, being able to read at grade level by the third grade is a primary indication of whether you're going to graduate from high school. If you don't graduate from high school, if you're a male, your chances of winding up in prison are significantly increased. If you're a female, your chances of winding up on a welfare system are significantly increased. Nobody should want that for our society. So that's why we've got to continue to press for improving the quality of education so that we don't have to listen to the nightly news about teenagers, children in some cases who should be in school that are out stealing, killing, robbing, carjacking, all of those things. I'm disappointed that within the media itself, nobody ever asked the questions, why is it that a 14-year-old has committed murder? Why weren't they in school? Mandatory law of attendance, they're 2 years yet left to go. We never hold anybody in the education community responsible, or in some cases, we don't hold the parents responsible either. Now, one of the changes that we made fairly recently is we put a provision in place where the juvenile court judges now have greater discretion to begin to put requirements on the parents or guardians of juveniles who are committing some of these crimes. That's one pressure point that I think will need to continue to be reinforced. So it's a difficult cycle to break, but we cannot allow it to continue. Children who are raised in poverty are never going to get out of poverty if they don't have an education. They're never going to get out of poverty if their life cycle is simply plagued by people around them who are violators of the law. We've got to break that cycle. An education leads to a job, and if you get a job, you're going to work your way out of those kind of environments. So not everybody, but I think a vast majority of them will. So it is not just something that the legislature can solve by talking about the criminal justice system. It is something that as a society we have to address in a much broader context, and education reform and the importance of making known that if you don't get an education, the consequences for you are not very good, and putting that as a premium. That's going to take a lot of work, and our state is not alone in that. Virtually every state has that problem. But just as we have led the way with these kind of meaningful criminal justice reforms, I would like to see us lead the way in those other areas that relate to it very directly.